Leia here from LeiaForSci.com, and in this video, I will show you the SN1 reaction, rate, and mechanism. Before we go into the mechanism, what is SN1? SN1 stands for Substitution Nucleophilic Unimolecular. Substitution is when I have a molecule that has a substituent X, and I simply substitute it for substituent Y. Nucleophilic comes from the word nucleophile, which breaks down into nucleus and loving. In other words, a nucleophile is a molecule that is attracted to positive charge. And since the nucleus is positive, we can say that a nucleophile is positive seeking. And what type of molecule is attracted to positive? It'll have to be something that is negative or partially negative due to electronegativity and lone pairs of electrons. And finally, unimolecular means that the reaction takes place one molecule at a time, or a first-order reaction. Many students confuse this to think SN1 is one step, but an SN1 reaction can actually be two or three steps, so don't mix this up. So let's take a look at the SN1 reaction. If I have a molecule with a leaving group on a secondary or tertiary carbon, the leaving group can grab the electrons that attach it to the carbon, breaking away. This leaves you with a carbocation, or a carbon with a positive charge, and a leaving group in solution. A weak nucleophile will be attracted to this positive charge and use its lone pair of electrons to attaching itself to the carbon chain, giving me a final product that has the nucleophile attached where the leaving group used to be, and this is where we get the idea of the substitution reaction. Let's analyze this a bit further. The first step of this reaction, where the carbocation forms, is a very slow step because you're taking a carbon chain that starts out neutral and giving it a positive charge. Now, even though carbon is not highly electronegative and can form a stable carbocation, we're still talking about going from neutral to charged, and that's not very happy. Because the intermediate is not very happy, this will be a very slow step. So slow, in fact, that this is the rate-determining step of the reaction. As soon as that positive charge forms, the nucleophile comes into attack, and that is considered a very fast step of the reaction. Now let's discuss this in terms of kinetics. The rate of any reaction is dependent on some constant K, which you don't have to worry about in organic chemistry, times the concentration of any molecules involved in the rate determining step. Since the alkyl chain that forms the carbocation is the rate determining step, we'll say that the rate is simply K times the concentration of the alkyl chain. Since the rate is only dependent on one molecule, this is considered a first order reaction, which gives you the one in unimolecular. So what is a first order reaction? It's a reaction whose rate will change dependent on the concentration of the alkyl chain. This means if you double the concentration of your starting carbon molecule, the reaction rate will double. If you triple it, the reaction rate will triple. However, because the nucleophile is not part of that rate determining step, if you double or triple the concentration of the nucleophile, you will see no change in the speed of your reaction. Now let's analyze the SN1 reaction that happens when 2-bromo-2-methylpropane reacts with acid in the presence of water. There are four things you want to look at anytime you study a reaction to determine between substitution and elimination, or the 1 and 2 type reactions. I have detailed videos that go into every analysis step, which you can find on my website, leiaforsci.com/substitution-elimination. The first thing to analyze is the alkyl chain. Recall that we said in order to have a 1 type, in this case an SN1 reaction, we have to have the leaving group sitting on a carbon that is capable of holding a positive charge. Tertiary and secondary carbons make stable carbocations, and in this case, we have a tertiary carbon holding the leaving group, meaning we will have a stable carbocation. Bromine as a leaving group forms a large negative halogen in solution, and due to its size, it's able to distribute that negative charge, making it relatively stable and therefore willing to leave. Since we're looking at substitution reactions, we're not looking at the base as much as the nucleophile, but in this case, we don't appear to have one. All we see is H+ in solution, but H+ is merely a catalyst. What we do see, however, is a solvent that has an electronegative atom capable of interacting with this molecule, resulting in a solvolysis reaction. Solvolysis is a term that explains a solvent that also acts as the nucleophile or base in solution, meaning you're reacting the molecule directly with your solvent. H2O as an attacking molecule does have an electronegative atom with lone pairs of electrons. Because we're in a positive or acidic solution, we cannot form a negative oxygen because that would be too strong of a base or nucleophile. However, given that we're in a positive acidic solution, a neutral electronegative oxygen, while a weak nucleophile, is still considered strong enough to attack. And finally, we have our solvent. Water is considered a very polar protic molecule, meaning that it has polarity that can stable any intermediates that form in this reaction. When the carbocation forms, the partially negative oxygen in water will stabilize that positive charge, and when bromine leaves and gets a negative charge in solution, that negative will be surrounded by the partially positive hydrogen on the water molecule. According to these four factors, everything here does point to a stable SN1 reaction, so let's see what the mechanism looks like. This reaction starts out when bromine grabs the electrons that connected to the carbon chain and breaks away from the carbon atom. Carbon used to have four bonds and now has only three, leaving it deficient and giving it a formal charge of +1. Bromine now has eight lone pairs of electrons, giving it a formal charge of -1. When working through the SN1 and E1 reactions, be sure that you always pay attention to your charges and ensure that you don't lose or gain anything along the way. The first step in my reaction has a net charge of 0 because it's a neutral molecule. The next or intermediate step of the reaction has a positive charge on the carbon, a negative charge on bromine. Because positive and negative cancel out, once again we still have a net charge of 0. Notice that bromine sits comfortably in solution, surrounded by the partially positive hydrogens of the water molecule. I'm not going to show the oxygen surrounding the carbocations, but do understand that it happens. Instead, we'll jump to the next step of this reaction, where a water molecule will use its lone pair of electrons to attack the positive carbon, forming a bond between carbon and oxygen. Since oxygen donated one of its lone pairs to the bond, it has just one lone pair left, giving it a formal charge of +1. This is where you want to pay attention. Even though oxygen is the atom holding the positive charge, you will never have another oxygen come and attack that positive oxygen because the oxygen is still an electronegative atom. Instead, what you're going to see is the electronegative oxygen pulling some of the electron density from the oxygen-hydrogen bond towards itself, making the oxygen slightly less positive, but at the same time, making the hydrogen atoms partially positive. Another water molecule that's in solution will use its lone pairs to grab one of the hydrogen atoms off of our molecule, giving the bonding electrons to the oxygen atom. The final product will have an oxygen attached to the carbon chain with two lone pairs of electrons and a neutral charge. We can also show the side product of the hydronium with a positive charge, as well as the Br-. Once again, if we take a net charge, the molecule is neutral and therefore has a charge of 0. The hydronium is our acid catalyst regenerated with a positive charge, and the bromide in solution has a negative charge. We have a conservation of charge because the hydronium and bromide cancel each other out. A common question I receive from students is, where does that second water molecule come from? When you're given a reaction, don't limit yourself to just one starting molecule and just one solvent molecule. Think about your most recent organic chemistry lab. When you do a reaction in a lab, you take an entire beaker full of your chemical to react. That means you have thousands and thousands of molecules available for reaction, and so we're reacting this on a large scale. When you dissolve in water, we're talking about a virtually infinite number of water molecules constantly surrounding your reactant and waiting to attack. So when you work through the mechanism and you need to find another water molecule to react, remember that you have an infinite number surrounding your molecule waiting to attack, so go ahead and use as many as you need. Be sure to join me in SN1 Video 2, where I focus on concepts like stereochemistry, carbocation rearrangement, and speed of reaction. Are you struggling with organic chemistry? Are you looking for information to guide you through the course and help you succeed? If so, download my ebook, 10 Secrets to Acing Organic Chemistry, using the link below, or visit leahforsythe.com/orgosecrets. That's O-R-G-O secrets. For information regarding online tutoring, visit leahforsythe.com/orgotutor. That's O-R-G-O tutor. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up and even share it with a friend or two.
If you have any questions regarding this video, leave a comment below or contact me through my Facebook page at facebook.com/LeahForsythe. There will be many related videos posted over the course of the semester, so go ahead and click the subscribe button to ensure that you don't miss out.